Hello viewers, today we speak of a very important dimension of public administration, bureaucracy. Now we are all very familiar with the term bureaucracy, but what is bureaucracy in public administration? By bureaucracy, before getting into a very academic definition, we would just like to say that by bureaucracy, we always mean a few other terms as well. We often talk of public servants, we talk of civil servants, we speak of officials of the government, we speak of permanent executive, we speak of many people relating to any work as far as the governmental functions are concerned. And loosely, we term all these people as being a part of the bureaucracy. So what is the bureaucracy actually? Bureaucracy in public administration would mean those people who are the permanent political executive of the government. How do we put it? Bureaucracy in public administration would mean those people, the people who are in government service, but not tenurally, not for 5 years or 10 years, but for a permanent period, so long as they do not reach the retirement age. And they are the people, the permanent staff of the executive organ of the government. So essentially, bureaucracy or the civil service constitutes the permanent and the professional part of the government. And it is usually described, very importantly, as a non-political, that is politically neutral, and professionally trained civil service. So the civil service of the government, which is non-political, which is permanent, and which always is supposed to stay politically neutral, forms bureaucracy in any kind of government. Now, as far as the bureaucracy is concerned, we have to keep in mind that any kind of government, its running, its success or its failure always depend on the kind of bureaucracy and the efficacy of the bureaucracy of that very country. Upon the qualities, positive or negative, upon efficiency, once again positive or negative, would depend how a government is going to run. Why is it so? We get into that. But before getting into that, we would just like to speak of the narrow and the broad definition of bureaucracy. Now, we often speak of people working as a bureaucrat. We often speak of people in being the civil service. So this is essentially a narrow sense of bureaucracy, meaning thereby we are talking of only those people who are in the top level government official positions, which is a narrow position. But actually, people from lower class peons to clerks to top level officials, all the people actually are supposed to be belonging to the category of bureaucracy. For the purpose of our definition, we are going to take this broad category, meaning thereby we are going to talk of all those people who from the class of clerks to the highest level officials are going to come under the purview of this category of bureaucracy. With this, we come to the main features of bureaucracy one by one. The first character of bureaucracy is its permanent character. What does that mean? It means that the bureaucracy, the people who are the elected civil servants, they are going to be permanent in nature. And they are, of course, going to continue in service so long as their retirement does not commence. It could either be 58 or 60 or 62 according to the year wherever they are working. But the bureaucrats, under normal circumstances, are not going to be removed from the government. Under any circumstance, mind you, under any circumstance would mean the change of government would not bring in any kind of change in the composition of the structure of bureaucracy. The second very important dimension of bureaucracy is that the fact that it is a hierarchical organization. What is hierarchy? By hierarchy, we essentially mean gradation. What is gradation? It means that bureaucracy is gradationally organized in several levels. Each official is placed at a particular level of hierarchy, as if they are all placed in the stairs. And each person is going to work according to his hierarchical position. We are going to get into more of this later. Right now, the third character, it is a non-partisan character, a very important feature. The members of the bureaucracy are not and should not be involved in any kind of direct political intervention or activity in the country. They cannot join any political party. They cannot participate in any kind of political movement, and they should not be affected by any political changes of the government, because as we just now said, that the bureaucracy is supposed to be permanent. If somebody has a partisan attitude, or if somebody is having some kind of political color, then that person is definitely going to be chided for, you know, for being something which he or she should not be. It is expected that the bureaucrats should perform all their duties which are assigned to them, being politically completely neutral, which accounts for being their non-partisan people. Fourth, they are the professional, trained and expert class. We have three terms here: professional. Why professional? Because they are professionally trained people. Trained, why trained? Because as we all know that these people are not elected, but they are selected through a very tough examination traditionally. And after they are selected, they are being trained so that they become very professional people. And not only do they become professional, it is expected that this training would make them experts in the field where they are going to perform their duties. So professional, trained and expert they are supposed to be. Very important is that they have fixed salaries, which is the next point. Bureaucrats are always supposed to have a fixed salary, meaning thereby that the bureaucrats are not under any kind of jeopardy that after the fall of the government, they might lose their job or there might be some curtailing of their salary or perks or privileges. Nothing of that sort. The bureaucrats work in such a way that they are expected to perform their work complete independently, and it is expected and they are being told that you do not have to worry about your salary because that is fixed. And to that, add that they have lots of perks and privileges which, you know, just conform to the salary or the salary structures to which they perform and to which they belong. So all the civil servants belonging to any specific class of administrative hierarchy are of course based in one scale of pay, which they mean, meaning thereby that the bureaucrats, all the bureaucrats in one level are going to get the same level of payment and there would not be any kind of discrimination within them in that structure. The next point is, once again very important, that the bureaucrats are always bound by specific rules and regulations. What does that mean? It means that the bureaucracy, the civil servants, would always, without fail, work under all the rules and regulations as written in the constitution of the country. Strict obedience to rules, working through proper channel, decision making after satisfying the rules are the principles which always guide, direct and regulate bureaucracy. Why is it that the rules and regulations are so very important? Remember, we have been talking of hierarchy. So whenever we are talking of hierarchy, it means that a specific person is given a specific workload and he is to work on that. He should not in any way step into other people's zones. Now, as a human being, it is always a tendency for a person to step into other people's zones. Not necessarily that the person is doing it deliberately, but it often happens that the person, by being helpful, by being overly helpful, can always come and say that I want to help you out. But the bureaucracy, the structure of bureaucracy does not help in any of that. Bureaucracy is always of the opinion, and bureaucrats are to maintain this, that one bureaucrat who is assigned one specific layer or tier should only be working in that zone which in which he or she has been given the job, and that job should not be done just according to the whims of that person, but every effort and care should be taken that the work that is being done should be done following all the rules and regulations of the constitution. The next point which we talk of is a class consciousness. This may be taken positively as well as negatively. Why? This is because the civil servants, as it is seen, often have a very high class consciousness. We began our lecture by saying that the people who are the top level bureaucrats are known as the civil servants. Now, the people who know that they are top level bureaucrats, of course, they are of the very high opinion of themselves. In their self-estimation also, they know that they are working in a very high position. So this adds to a class consciousness that I belong to the higher level of society. I belong to a very upper level and I should act according to my class. You know, as you can well understand, this can be positive as well as negative, because a person can be conscious of his class, and that is fine as long as and so long as it does not percolate into his working into any other zone negatively. But if a person is extremely class conscious, then of course that becomes somewhat negative, in the sense that that person becomes somewhat narrow, arrogant and proud. So it is true that the bureaucrats are essentially class conscious, but this is also true that special care is also taken so that they in no way bypass what is exactly expected of them and do something out of their arrogance and pride. The next feature which we talk of as feature is the public service spirit as the ideal of the bureaucrats. What is public service spirit? The bureaucrats should always keep in mind that they are here to help the public. They are here to help the people. They are here not for themselves, but to aid the running and ruling of the government. Because of this reason, it is always said that the bureaucrats should, in their mind, always know that the basic ideal they should aim to work towards is that they should always want to help the public, emerge in work which would once again lead them to do public service. And not only just in thought, they should keep this as their basic essential ideal, that the spirit of public service, the spirit of helping and aiding the people, should be topmost and foremost in their mind. Next, we talk of a specific code of conduct which is expected of the civil servants as they work in the country. By code of conduct, it is meant that they have to act in a very disciplined manner. Their rights, duties, privileges are extremely clearly defined. The procedure through which they work is definite and settled. What is very important over here is, it is not just that these are mentioned, these rules are just there for them to follow. If it is found that the bureaucrats deviate from these rules, if it is found that they do not act as expected, severe punishment is given out to them also. Misbehavior on the part of the bureaucrats under any circumstance, incompetence at any level, and negligence for any purpose or violation of conduct of rules is just not looked upon well. The misbehavior, the incompetence, the negligence, and the violation, if any of these four is found on any civil servant, then of course it is found that the civil servant is given due punishment for that. So in short, the bureaucracy here, we can say that as far as the features are concerned, they stand for neutrality, professional competence, a very permanent and stable nature, fixed salaries, and strict obedience to rules. Now we come to the functions of bureaucracy. What does a bureaucracy do actually? Till now we have spoken of the characteristics of bureaucracy. What does a bureaucracy do? The bureaucracy or the civil service plays a very key role in running the public administration of a country. You can very well understand that this is a very profound statement. It is the bureaucracy, once again I repeat, which helps in aiding and running the government. How is that done? How does the bureaucracy do it? By a few steps, of course. We talk of the steps one by one. The bureaucracy first implements the governmental policies and laws. So it is the first and foremost duty of the bureaucracy to implement the policies of the government. Good policies and laws can always serve their objectives if these are properly and efficiently implemented by the civil servants. So it is like, you know, policy is there, but the policy, if well and if not implemented properly, is not going to lead to any good purpose. So implementation of a policy is something which the civil servant has to look for. Second is its role in policy formulation. Policy function is, of course, the function of political executive, which is the government. However, the bureaucracy plays a very important role in this exercise. We are saying that the political executive, which is the executive part of the government, its role is actually to formulate its duty is to formulate the policy-making function in the government. But as we know, that the government people, the people who are the ministers, they are always not having the technical know-how to formulate and take part and discuss and take part in deliberations and thereby form any kind of policy. For this, once again, the help of the civil servants is solicited. What do the civil servants do? They are the ones who supply data to the political executive for formulating these policies. In fact, the civil servants actually formulate several alternative politics and give these to the political executive with merits and demerits of all these ones. So it's like, you know, the government officials, the government people, the ministers, they are given different kinds of policies with merits and demerits. It is finally the duty of the government to select from those alternatives which ones they want. But mind you, all the policies are that of the bureaucrats. So therein lies a very important function of bureaucracy. From this, of course, comes the third one, a very important one once again. If you can see that we have been speaking of first and second ones, that the bureaucrats, they formulate the policies, bureaucrats, they implement the policies. So as a third one, could we not say that the bureaucrats are actually running the administration? Of course they are. They are running the administration because in accordance to the laws, rules, regulations and decisions of the government, it is the key responsibility of the bureaucracy to, you know, see so that these things are always in place and the government runs properly. What does the political executive do then? The political executive only simply exercises guiding, controlling and supervising functions. So while the ministers, we know that they finally just sign on the dotted lines, but it is the duty of the bureaucrats, essential duty of the bureaucrats to formulate the policy, to implement the policy and to see whether these are helpful and whether these are properly aiding in running the administration. So we can of course say that the running the government largely and to a great extent depends on the bureaucracy. We come to number four, the advisory function of bureaucracy. Now, one of the very important functions of the bureaucracy is to advise the political executive. So whenever we are talking of advisory function of the bureaucracy, we would speak in such a way that the advice being spoken over here is the advice given to the political executive. The ministers receive all kinds of information and advice relating to the functioning of their respective departments from the civil servants. As amateurs, as I have already spoken, that the ministers have little knowledge and function about the departments. For this, they have to depend on the civil servants entirely. They therefore depend on the civil servants completely as qualified, experienced and expert people guiding them all the way through. So professional advice giving and professional advice seeking on the part of political executive stands as a major function of the bureaucracy. Next is the role of the bureaucracy in legislative work. The civil servants play a very important, but mind you, an indirect role in legislature making or law making. They draft the bills that the ministers submit to the legislature for law making. So the ministers, the bills which the ministers place to the legislature are actually prepared by the civil servants. The ministers provide all the information asked by the legislature. How do they provide all this information? With the help of the civil servants. So it is the civil servants who obviously help the ministers with all kinds of legislative work. Semi-judicial work. The civil servants take part in doing that as well. The emergence of the system of administrative service, under which the several types of cases and disputes are decided by the executive, has further been increased as seen as part of a job of the civil servants. So the civil servants actually help the executive in performing certain judicial work, like they help the ministers in certain disputes, how has that got to be solved, how the disputes are going to be resolved, and the ministers just work according to the aid and advice of the civil servants. We can speak of many licenses, permits, tax concessions, quotas, etc. How do the ministers behave in such situations when any kind of impending danger faces them? It is always seen that the civil servants help the ministers out by giving proper advice in such semi-judicial cases. collection of taxes and disbursement of financial benefits. These are the next two important functions of the bureaucracy. Now, we have to know that the bureaucrats play a very important function as far as the financial administration of the government is concerned. They advise the political executive in respect of all kinds of financial planning, tax structure, tax administration, and the like. They collect taxes, settle disputes involving recovery of taxes as well. They play a very major and important role in preparing the budget and taxation proposals. They carry out the function of granting of legally sanctioned financial benefits, tax reliefs, subsidies, and other concessions to the people. Now, while I'm reading out these, you can as well understand that these are the essential features of financial administration. In the name of the ministers, it is actually the civil servants who are actually guiding them to formulate all kinds of financial administrative policies. And the ministers, without any question, generally, mind you, generally, because there are always exceptions, the ministers take the help of the civil servants in this regard, and accordingly, they formulate all kinds of decision as far as the financing is concerned. Record keeping is a very major role and function of the bureaucracy. It has the sole, mind you, the sole responsibility of keeping systematically all kinds of government records. Many of us will not know that it is the civil service which actually keeps record of all kinds of governmental documents ever since India became independent, and even before that as well. They collect, classify, and analyze all data pertaining to all the activities of government and store them properly. Why is this necessary? Just like that? Definitely not, because they collect these data and they maintain this properly because vital socioeconomic statistics come out of these data. Why are these necessary? These are necessary for the formulation of public policies and plans. As we all know that public policies and plans can only be formulated keeping in mind the needs and necessities of the public. So these can only be done if we get to know what the public demanded, what the public wanted, what the public got, did the public become happy with that, did they become very unhappy with that. So all kinds of socioeconomic data, these had to come into being, and these are thereby stored for future policy formulation and planning. A very important role of bureaucracy is its functioning in public relations affairs. What does that mean? This means that in the era of modern welfare state and democratic politics, it is essential for the government to keep very close relations with the people of the state. They need this to maintain active and full public relations. And it is not just a fact that this is being done only at the center. It is being done in all the states also. What does the civil service do actually? The civil servants, they act as a bridge between the government and the common people. So on the one hand, they communicate all the governmental decisions to the people. On the other hand, they communicate to the government the needs, interests, and views of common people. So the bureaucracy thereby plays a vigorously important, active, and highly important role in the working of the government. Now, we have spoken of functions of bureaucracy. From these, is it not absolutely necessary for us to feel and understand that the bureaucrats are a very important part of the government? But what happens when somebody thinks of himself or herself as very important? We all had spoken of this right now, a little before, that pride, arrogance, and all such negative aspects of the character comes to the forefront. Bureaucracy is no exception thereafter. Thereby, definitely, there has to be some control over bureaucracy, that the bureaucrats who are so powerful remain under some kind of control. So there's this additional need for controlling the bureaucracy. How can these be controlled? These can be controlled in two ways, internally and externally. The tools of internal control are, I take one by one, budgeting, accounting, auditing, reports, inspections, efficiency surveys, personnel control, code of conduct, and discipline control. What are these, the words which I just spoke out? These are various means with the help of which the bureaucracy can be controlled internally. For example, budgeting. If there's proper budgeting, then the civil servants can never go beyond the limits of the budget. There, if there is accounting, if there is auditing, then they cannot spend according to their own whims. If they are supposed to present reports, then obviously they are in no way to just morph the reports. Efficiency surveys, of course, their inefficiency will come out. Personnel control, the controlling the people who work in the bureaucracy, that also is a major feature which can also be controlled. So these are the vital essential features for internal control. What are the external control features? Of course, we can very well understand that these external control agencies are the legislature, the executive, the judiciary, and the common people. So it is the executive organ, the legislative organ, and the judicial organ. These three organs can together or individually externally control the bureaucracy and curb them when they feel that they are going out of hand. And of course, finally, it is the people who just decide that the bureaucrats are going out of their hand and they have to be brought to book. So far, we speak of what bureaucracy is in narrow and broad definition form. We speak of what are its basic features and we speak of what are its functions. We thereby speak of the various controls over bureaucracy and how bureaucracy can be controlled. Now, as we can see that we have spoken of bureaucracy at a very general level, at a very common parlance, but what do experts say about bureaucracy? What do sociologists have to say about bureaucracy? What are the theorizings which have gone for bureaucracy? Thank you so much.